is back. God left it, probably the worst summer so far. We've had other rough ones too, Lord, I appreciate your prayers and your concern and the lovely cards that we both got through this ordeal over the last little while, so thank you. It's good to see you all. We're going to go to the big board first, and then I got a couple other announcements. Welcome, all of you who are online viewers. Yes, it is me. I am back. We're glad that you are able to tune in online and share in this service. If you have any sound or tech issues at home, please contact the church office. We have people that might be able to help you with that. Yes, coming in September, and people are asking me questions, and the problem is that I've been so out of commission, I haven't even got the bare bones really figured out yet, but we're going to do a four-part session on what it means to be a Christian. It's just very, very basic Christian stuff, okay? So think of it that way, Christianity 101. I'm not even sure when we're going to start it, but we're going to get the details put together and announce that shortly. Oh, yeah, VBS, what a week. Wow, it was incredible. I know you, everybody likes statistics. We had 60 children, which was capacity, registered. Now, not all came, but we had a few last-minute additions, so in the end, it was pretty close to that number. And it was a lot of fun. The sanctuary looks considerably different than it did on Friday. I mean, really different. So we are, there's the group photo of everybody who was either participating or leading or doing all kinds of stuff there. Is there other photos for that? No, later on in the children's time, we're going to show you a photo montage of some things that happened. There is an announcement related to Vacation Bible School, though, I want to share with you. Janet has asked me to ask some of you to help after church put away some of the bigger items of decoration. You might see there's some boards and things over here, and the hut, it's all got, we need extra bodies to do that. So if you can help in any way, shape, or form, please do that. Where are we here? Oh, please stay for refreshments after the service. Our friends over here. Is that it? Okay, I remembered. Let me get this out of the way first. I just want to pass along to you one very significant prayer request. Our dear friend Liz Harvey is not very well. Her cancer has come back in a big way and is expanding, and she's quite ill. So please keep Liz and the family in your prayers. Now, those of you who are familiar with this congregation know that there's a certain gentleman in this congregation who claims to have given Sue all her singing ability or trained her. And this particular individual has a significant day today, and Sue's going to sing for him to show so we can see how good his teaching is.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Sorry, honey, but God bless me with being on worship on your birthday. So, after my Shane likes to sing little ditties around the house. Kids will tell you. They're old ones. They're not anything the rest of us would sing, but you probably remember the tune to this one. I've changed the words a bit. How old is my husband, Mr. Ferguson? The one who taught me all I know. How old is the guy they call Fergie? He's 60. But it doesn't show. Right.
Oh, boy. Okay. We got to ask. How did you do?
Awesome.
Oh, there you go. That's good. That's good. So, again, let's prepare ourselves for worship. With prayer, let us pray. As you came, O God, seeking Moses, you have come seeking us. And you say to us, as you did to him, I stretch out my hand and let you go. But we do not merely echo the request of Moses for deliverance from bondage. assured that freedom and all these other things shall be added unto us. We pray only for the gift of your presence in our lives.
Thank you.
many of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of honor and majesty in his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has gained renown by his wonderful deeds. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever.
Please join me in unison for the prayer of confession.
Have mercy upon us, O God, for sin clings so closely, and its burden is great. Because of sin, our hands are at our sides, when they should reach out to others. Our knees are shaky, when we should be standing firm. We are victims of our own misdeeds. We cannot escape sin's weight on our lives. Through Christ's intercession, lift the burden from us and help us walk in your freedom and in strength. Amen.
Having confessed your sin and having sought the Lord, may you experience his mercy and be assured of his presence and his pardon. From Deuteronomy 16, verses 16 to 17, we read these words. No one shall come into the presence of the Lord empty-handed. Each of you shall bring such a gift as he can, portions of the blessing which the Lord your God has given you. Since we've presented our gifts already in the offering plate at the front, let us now offer our gifts to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Our gracious Lord, we are indeed grateful for your grace and your mercy that pours out upon us. We are thankful, Father, that you offer us an opportunity to show that we too can be generous. We too can be caring. We too can participate in your kingdom. Receive these gifts we have sent, provided for you, and we ask you that you bless them, multiply them, and use them for your glory. Amen.
The children can come forward now with their godly prayers.
Yes, today for our children's song, we're going to see some pictures, and these three have seen them, but the rest of you haven't, so enjoy the picture show from Vacation Bible School.
Thank you.
teaching Bible school. Yeah. And I know she doesn't want me to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway. I don't know what we would have done without Janet, or where she's hired. Where she's up there. I don't have words for all that she does for us and for Vacation Bible School. Anyway, I do have a little bit of a story to tell you today, and these kids all look familiar. I don't know about that. I think they all have a little bit of me in each one of them. It's possible. How many of you, and I know the answer to this, see, that's the problem, I know you so well. How many of you like stories? Who likes stories? Anybody? Do you like stories? How many of you like stories? I love stories. I like reading stories. I like hearing stories. I like seeing stories played out on TV or in the movies or whatever it is. I love stories. One of the things that always has amazed me are people who write stories, who do amazing work of creating stories out of here, and maybe out of their hearts too. We have a decorated author in our congregation. I don't know how many people remember that. And she has a new book out. And it's Darrell Maguire, by the way. And she has a new book out. And this is not really a commercial because that's not what I'm doing here. But I read it. It's called The Outsmarters. She brought it over to the house to give me a copy. She does that. So get a chance to read it. Have a shot. Laura had to read through it. And there's a part that I want to read to you today that she wrote. And it says, "Good morning, Kate," Reverend Maguire says, smiling as if I had not disrupted so many of his services with my squirming and arguing with Grand. "Your grandmother told me about your booth, and I had to come and see it for myself. Congratulations on your business." And there's a little bit before that says, "Reverend Maguire walks up to my booth. I saw him walk out of Grand's store. He often goes there to look at antique fishing equipment. He's the minister at the church Grand took me to so I could learn to sit still." So I asked her in email, I haven't got a reply yet, who's going to play me the movie version? I asked her to say that. Anyway, I think it's amazing, people that can write stuff, write stories. But you know what I learned? God has written your life as a story. Have you ever thought of that? He's got every minute of it written out and prepared for you. He knows when it begins, he knows what's going to happen, and he knows, yes, when it's going to end this part, and then he knows what's going to happen for eternity. Isn't that amazing? God is the one who creates and writes your life. I think that's amazing. And you can put in your suggestions for who's going to play in the movie, if you like. I said, let's pray now. Dear Lord, thank you that you have us all in your heart and in your mind, that you love us, and you have a whole story of our life prepared for us. Help us to trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, grandkids, you can all head out for lovely play.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson today is from John 6, 47 to 58. John 6, 47 to 58. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is the true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. This is the word of the gospel. Thanks be to Christ. What sustains you? There was a trial, and the judge asked the older woman why she stole a can of peaches from the local store. She replied, Your Honor, my husband and I don't have much, and we are very poor. I was simply trying to do something about my hunger. And the judge, feeling sorry for the older ladies, asked, how many peaches were in the can? Six, the older lady replied. Then the judge said, you will spend one day in jail for each peach, for a total of 6 days. Suddenly from the gallery of the courtroom, this voice shouted out, Your Honor! It was the husband of the woman on trial. I should tell you she also stole a can of peas. Didn't see that coming. I admit it. I'm sure you will all be shocked just looking at me for me to confess that I enjoy eating food. I know, it's hard to believe. Yet most people I know also enjoy eating food, good food usually. I can also guess that at least some of you here today are like Laura and I, who nearly daily wrestle with the most significant of all life's questions. What will we have for supper? Which is often followed by an examination of what options are available in the fridge or the freezer or the cupboard or whatever. You ever notice how much of our life's experience and energy is spent in the pursuit of the enjoyment of food? This fixation on food is really completely understandable given our need as living beings to have to ingest food so that we can sustain our lives, be happy. If we go too long without food, the consequences for our health and our vitality are quite significant. As a culture, we've even coined a slang term to describe what happens to a great number of us when we go too long without food. Have you ever heard a grouchy person described as being hangry? Hangry, H-A-N-G-R-Y. Young children, as a grandfather picks them up after school, I can attest to this, are particularly prone to this after their blood sugar gets too low. After school snacks are essential to just survive the insanity of that time between getting home from school and supper time. Our personal need and connection to food will help us, I think, understand what happened to the Israelites so long ago in the wilderness when they exited from Egypt. These Israelites, and there were a lot of them, they were wandering around in the desolate place called the wilderness, And like you and me, they eventually got hungry. They used up their supplies and they had no more food. They got hungry, and the first thing they did as they got hungry was they started to grumble at Moses, who was their leader, and they began to grumble at God. They were a whole horde of very angry people. They went so far as to suggest that God had led the Israelites just out to the wilderness to just starve them to death. By the way, denying the goodness of God is a form of blasphemy, by the way. There are also incidents, you may remember from the story, where they got very thirsty. And they grumbled about that too. Things got so desperate for the Israelites in the wilderness that they began to suggest amongst themselves and even to Moses that we should just go back to Egypt. They might be slaves in Egypt, but at least there in Egypt they got food and water. Moses reacts, or reaches out to God actually, he does it quite angrily, and he pleads for food for the Israelites. I think his pleading with God was more about getting him to stop grumbling at him than actually feeding them, but who knows. Well, if you read the story, God does send them aid. He rains down manna from heaven. And there's another incident where at one point, for protein, he sends a huge flock of quail into the camp, and they have birds to eat, give them some protein. God, in his benevolence, gives them manna, gives them sustaining grace. It is a food that at least will tide the Israelites over until eventually they reach the promised land, which was 40 years of wandering, by the way. They probably got tired of manna after a while, right? But all this plays very nicely into the scene that that's described in John 6 when Jesus uses the term bread of life. Jesus was trying to get away from the crowds at this point in John 6. He was tired, and he wanted a break. So he had his disciples cross the Sea of Galilee, but guess what? The crowds still followed them and walked around or sailed across the sea on their own. And the crowd grew and grew and grew. And finally, Jesus says to Philip, "Well, Philip, we've got to feed these people. How are we going to feed these people?" Philip answers in a display of little faith that they don't have enough money to give everybody here even the smallest morsel of food. Finally, Andrew, problem solver maybe, he brings to Jesus a boy. And this little boy, very famous story, right? He has 5 small loaves of bread, kind of like buns really, nothing more, and 2 dried fish. And with that amount, Jesus miraculously feeds this throng of thousands of people. And there's still 12 baskets of food left over. After that, Jesus and the disciples, they go back across the other side of the Sea of Galilee. When the crowd sees that Jesus had left, they follow him again. And Jesus takes this moment to teach them a critical lesson. He accuses the crowd of ignoring his miraculous signs and only following him because they get a free meal. That's what they want, free food. Jesus tells them in John 6:27, "Do not labor for the food that perishes, for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has set a seal." In other words, this horde of people were so enthralled with getting bread that they could eat, they were missing out on the fact that the Messiah had come. Missed it. So the Jews asked Jesus, "Hey, wait a minute, if you're so special, give us a sign so that we know that God has sent you." He just fed them. And now they want another sign. They tell Jesus that God gave them manna from heaven during their desert wandering. And Jesus responds by telling them that they need to ask not for manna. They need to ask for the true bread from heaven that gives life. And they ask Jesus, okay, where do we get this bread? Tell us, what store is it in? Jesus startles them by saying this, and it's startling words. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. It's a powerful, powerful statement. First of all, Jesus is saying that he is bread. Jesus is saying that he is essential for our lives. Second, the life Jesus is referring to here is not a physical life, but an eternal life. Jesus is trying to get the Jews to stop thinking about their temporal existence and start thinking about their eternal existence. He is contrasting what he brings as the Messiah with the bread he miraculously created just the day before. That bread on the day before for the horde of people was bread that eventually would perish. Those 12 baskets of leftovers, if you left them alone, they rot, mold, they'd be done. Jesus is spiritual bread that brings eternal life. And third, and this is very important, Jesus is making a claim here to his divinity. It's very important that you see that. This statement is the first of the I am statements in the Gospel of John. I am the bread of life. That phrase, I am, is the covenant name of God revealed to Moses in the burning bush. It is revered by the Jews. The phrase speaks of the self-sufficient existence of God. It is an attribute that only God possesses. Is also a phrase the Jews who were listening that day, particularly the religious leaders, would have automatically understood as a claim to divinity by Jesus. They would have got it. Continuing in John 6 into today's passage, which I read for you, what would you think if I was to say to all of you today that Jesus is manna? Just like the food that sustained Israel both physically and spiritually in the wilderness, John 6:51 summarizes what Jesus has been saying since verse 32 of this chapter. I am the living bread that came down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. The death of which Jesus speaks is the death that threatened Israel under the harsh conditions of the desert. And the separation from God represented by the sentiment that they had that we'd be better off going back to Egypt than following God. Spiritually. Manna was God's solution provided in that situation. And Jesus is interpreting that story, that scripture, and identifying himself as manna. Jesus wants us to clearly draw a definitive line from that wilderness story to his presence and his sustaining grace in our lives. That there's something special about the manna that Jesus is. Jesus extends his interpretation in a new way in these verses. He begins to add something profoundly new to this idea that manna sustains life. Manna, Jesus says, manna, me, is the life eternal given to you. Whoever eats this bread, he says, will live forever. The phrase live forever is a variation of John's more common use phrase for the gifts Jesus provides. He uses most places eternal life. Throughout the Gospel of John, Jesus asserts that he's the bringer of eternal life for those who trust in him. The manna is already a story of God's life-giving power. Now Jesus uses this opportunity to clarify that he's the manna, but now this manna extends life eternally. As it is true elsewhere in the gospel, this life Jesus brings is not limited to a future heavenly existence after death. This is really important. You know, many modern Christians, if you talk to them about eternal life, especially when they've read the Gospels, they will immediately jump to the idea, well, that's when we die and we go to heaven. There's truth in that. That's the kind of way the synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, they talk about eternal life that way. For example, Matthew tells that incredible parable of the sheep and the goats at the coming of the Son of Man, and closes with the statement, and those will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The verbs, though, that John uses are present tense. They're now. The life Jesus brings begins during the life of the believer here now, and during Jesus' time of the incarnational existence on earth. It's now. We are living in eternal life now. Not after we draw our last breath. John is making it really clear to us that the life Jesus is offering us is quantitatively different than our regular human life. Eternal or forever is a characteristic that only belongs to the divine. The Lord sits enthroned as King forever, Psalm 29, verse 10. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, Psalm 32, 11. Forever is God's domain. It is a quality God possesses. Those who trust in Jesus have eternal life. We now participate in the divine life with God. When Jesus later says, I came that they might have life and have it abundantly, he's really saying the same thing. Those who abide in him share in the creative force of God who brought all things into being. And that's the life embodied in Jesus. But John adds one more difference between Jesus and the man in the Old Testament. Did you know that those folks in the wilderness who ate that manna, they eventually died? Did you know that? But those who eat of Jesus, the manna, will live forever, John 6. Now, that's not a criticism of what happened in the Old Testament at all. Rather, it's just suggesting that Jesus is one more step to us being with God, one more connection with God. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them. Those who eat are offered a union, therefore, with God that endures forever. Now, hearing all this, thinking about all this, reading the passage for yourself, I know you're probably thinking to yourself, boy, this sounds an awful lot like the Lord's Supper, like communion. Now, although communion is not mentioned explicitly here, we are invited by John to see it here. You might be surprised to learn that of the four Gospels, John has no institution of the Lord's Supper at all. Did you know that? In John's Gospel, at the last meal, the only thing that's mentioned there is the foot washing. But these words in John 6 identify a future gift of eating and drinking Jesus' flesh and blood, which certainly would invoke for all of us the Lord's Supper, and it did for the early Christians too. Verses suggest that a future meal with Jesus around his table is feeding on manna. Although the Proud introduced the manna story many years ago. Jesus is still giving us a new interpretation quoted in the scriptures. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. By interpreting the scripture verse this way, Jesus suggests that Jesus' giving of his flesh and his blood is a reiteration of the gift of bread from heaven to God. The future gift of bread, which Christ's readers understand, is the Lord's Supper. It's manna. Every time we gather here, it's manna. The manna imagery is often discarded when we think about the Lord's Supper. We emphasize more often than not the sacrificial language of this supper. Drawing on John's understanding, communion prayers might emphasize the story of God's enduring care for Israel in the Exodus story and invite those around the table, that's you and I, to understand ourselves as recipients of God's eternal care, his gift of life. Those who receive Jesus' body and blood might imagine themselves as the same as those who were wilderness travelers following God's pillar of fire and that cloud pillar, feeding on manna, which is thing. One of the things that's interesting to me, I've stressed this a lot over the years, is when I do a wedding ceremony, often after the ceremony, people, guests, sometimes family members will come up to me and say, "That was a very nice ceremony." Well, it's very kind of them. But you know, ceremonies, by definition, are really just a formal act or a set of acts performed to prescribe by ritual or custom, such as a wedding or a funeral or whatever it may be. And I tell the couples getting married all the time, I say, look, weddings are meant to be nice, but frankly, they're easy. Weddings are easy. But they're not an end in themselves. How many of you have been married more than 5 years? You know it's not an end in itself. You and I know, and hopefully the bride and groom will know, that once the ceremony is over, the hard work really begins. Our life as a married couple begins. The ceremony has an intended purpose that lies beyond itself. In other words, there's life beyond the ceremony. Last week, although I wasn't here, this fellowship gathered around this table. We do it every month to observe the Lord's Supper. It's a ceremony. It's a ritual, if you like. It too can be quite nice. It too can be a meaningful ceremony. But like a wedding, these ceremonies are not intended to be an end in themselves. Communion celebrations also speak of a life beyond the ceremony. You know, it would do little good, well, maybe a little good, if for a married couple to sit down on the couch and watch a video of their wedding ceremony. I don't know, we didn't have that back in our day, I guess. But it would do almost no good at all if they did not understand and grasp the emphasis that they now have a life to. As husband and wife, a life that began after the ceremony. You know, if there's anything that history of human religion tells us, is that people will seek to earn their way into heaven. There's all kinds of different ways. There's such a basic human desire within us because God created us with eternity in our mind. The Bible says that God has placed within us a desire for eternity in our hearts, Ecclesiastes 3:11. The Bible also tells us there's nothing we can do to earn our way into heaven because we've all sinned, Romans 3:23. The only thing that sin earns us is death. There's only one who is righteous in himself. It's Jesus.
Yes.
Our dilemma is that we have this desire, you and I, that we cannot fulfill no matter how hard we try. That is where Jesus comes in. That's what he's talking about today. He and He alone can fulfill the desire in our hearts for righteousness through the divine transaction. For our sake, he made Him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness, or become righteousness of God.
Amen.
When Jesus died on the cross, He took the sins of humankind upon Himself, and He was the atonement for all of us. When we place our faith in Him, our sins are now with Jesus. They're gone.
Yes.
And His righteousness is now in us.
Amen.
I tell you again, strongly, that only Jesus could ever satisfy our hunger. Only Him. Only He can quench our thirst for righteousness. No one else. Because He, He alone, is the bread of life.
Yes.
Let us pray together. Yes. Our gracious God, lover of all people, we admit we find ourselves a bit troubled today. Troubled by the inadequacy of our words in trying to pray, or in trying to praise Your name. We want so badly to honor You in our prayers, but we are left only with metaphors and poetic verses to direct our heartfelt thoughts. And these seem so inadequate. It troubles us even more, O God, that some in our human family see the ancient metaphors in Your ancient scriptures as somehow literal pictures of You. They use those ancient descriptions of You from time and culture to justify hatred, prejudice, and all kinds of evil. We know, even in our limited thoughts and words, that You are not vengeful. You are not an angry tyrant. Nor do You delight in our using rhetoric, even based on selected Bible verses, to condemn and exclude people from Your kingdom. Thank You for Jesus, O God, who demonstrated and taught repeatedly that the best way we could ever hope to understand You is by loving You and by loving others. How we marvel at Jesus, who warmly welcomed and dined with those who made the establishment, even the religious establishment, cringe and avoid. Thank You for Jesus, who taught us about the incredible power of even the smallest portion of Your presence to change lives and to bring hope. Help us, O God, to be more like Jesus. Stand boldly and to welcome fully those that even religious folks deem unworthy. Help us to look for the kingdom of God at work in our community of Simcoe. Help us to nurture the smallest seeds of hope so that entire families and neighborhoods can be radically renewed. We also thank You for Your Holy Spirit, who's always present in us and around us, who moves us unpredictably as the wind. We know the Spirit is like the wind in our sails. Without the Spirit at work in us and through us, we flounder. Without the Spirit, we are without hope in the face of life's great challenges. Where there is hope in the doctor's office, the cancer ward, the nursing home, the family in distress, where is the hope unless the Spirit is there? More than anything, O God, we long to be more confident in our faith. We long to face even the fiercest storm with a foundation built in the rock of Christ Jesus. O God, give us such confidence. And if we should falter, bring another brother or sister alongside us to ride out our storm with us. Thank You, O God, for those loving, kind souls who have been our refuge in the past. Thank You for the privilege of being that refuge for someone else in this day and age. Our Father, we give you thanks and all the glory for such a successful week here for the Vacation Bible School. We thank you for the volunteers. We thank you for the children who came and the parents that brought them. We pray, Father, that the seeds that were sown during this week will bear much fruit. And the hope and the love that you have for these children and for their families will just permeate every aspect of their life. And Father, this morning we lift up our sister Liz Harvey to you. Mm-hmm. And we pray, oh God, that you would draw close to her in each and every moment. Thank you for her family who lovingly surround her and support her. And may she draw her strength and encouragement from the fact that you love her. And you will be with her every step of this journey. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus. And for the wonderful words he taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn, Lord, I Need You.
I'm not afraid.
walked among us as one of us. You did not live among us as one of us. You lived and you loved not as we live in love, but as God lives and loves. You gave up your claim to earth's rewards for heavenly treasure. Grant us the grace to go and do likewise. Amen.